Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. It was recorded by Moses over 1,000 years before Jesus was ever born that the prophet whom God will send will be in his likeness. So people were looking for the signs somehow similar from the life of Moses to recognize if he is the one whom God has sent. And they challenged Jesus with this manna. Moses gave us manna, free food for 40 years in the desert. So if you are a prophet like Moses and you must be better than Moses, you have to do something better. And they needed immediately correction. They remembered what happened there in the desert, but they missed the message. It was not Moses. It was God, the Heavenly Father, who gave them this food for 40 years. And Moses was just praying for the gift of food because they were in the deserted place, and the Heavenly Father gave them this bread from heaven, and the real bread from heaven would be further when Jesus will institute the Eucharist and give us this Eucharistic bread forever. So it was a very big connection, and this gospel of today is obviously connected with the Mass, connected with the Eucharist. There is quite a lot of confusion and maybe unnecessary tension between the Masses of this old order and new order. And it was always in stages. Even here, the churches are built in stages, because Poland is like South Canada, so it's cold, and they are trying in one season, hot season, to build an underground church, which later is changed into classrooms or into offices or storages or anything like this. And then after the winter, they start to build the church up. It's very typical arrangement. And you do not contradict the Mass, which was under the ground, with this which is in the Mass, in the church, because it's the same Mass, it's just different circumstances. And this is what is happening with this extraordinary form in Latin and this Novo Ordo, as it's called, returning to the roots. You know, people who are saying that there was always Latin, they don't know what they are saying, because church at the beginning was Greek. For 3 centuries was Greek. And those who are saying that there were always organs in the church, they don't know what they are saying. Out of curiosity, I checked it yesterday, the organs were invented 3 centuries before Jesus was born, but they were introduced to the church in the 9th century. So 900 years of the church, there were no organs. Just don't play one against the other, because it doesn't make sense. Pope Benedict made a very wise decision, returning to this Latin Mass, let them influence each other. In fact, I wanted to do it in our church partly, at least partly during the Lenten season when we are coming to the Latin parts. Only in the Catholic Church you can have Latin. Yeah, that's what makes us a kind of special, because the altar is movable. Let us move altar towards tabernacle and we make this ad orientem Mass that priest is facing Jesus. So I'm on the heels of Jesus, you're on my heels, you know, going, worshipping with Jesus, our Heavenly Father. This what was the main meaning in this. But at the beginning, it was not like this. They didn't have tabernacles because they didn't have churches. They didn't have organs, but they didn't have churches. For 300 years, Christianity was forbidden religion, persecuted religion, and was one of the most flourishing at the time. You might also ask why God is allowing this confusion. It's not only on this topic. Surely God is allowing it because he will do something good out of it. And don't ask me what, because I don't know, not yet, but it will be obvious. If somebody was standing at the hill of Calvary and seeing this useless death of Jesus on the cross, and someone would tell that God allowed it to make something good out of it, he would say, you know, some cuckoo guy. And just 3 days later, it started to reveal. Out of this useless death, God make an instrument of salvation. So even out of this tension, this confusion which you have in the world, God will do something good and just make sure that you will try to tune to him. It takes time. And today, in a special way, maybe this is one of the invitations Read about the Mass. Scott Kahn wrote this book decades already ago, The Lamb's Supper, analyzing how it came to celebrate the Mass. There is a beautiful book on EWTN, Latin Mass. You can go there. When the translation was done, we did this workshop about a Mass starting, what is the meaning of the sign of the cross? It might be kind of a revival if we take it positively. And today I wanted to go with some kind of encouragement. Why is it that so many Catholics of deep faith have grown weary of the business as usual? Because instead of drawing them to God, it was like discouraging them. They felt that they need to flee to an older iteration of the faith in both liturgy and in theology because it was challenging them, motivating them. I remember from my early priesthood, I was passing several parishes going 80 miles to my spiritual director, not because there was no any other priest or his absolution would be not valid. But this priest who was my spiritual director in the seminary, he knew me, he challenged me, he motivated me, and was worth it to go 80 miles to make confession every other week. So the same is with the Mass. Instead of fighting each other, as Pope Benedict was encouraging, influencing each other, motivating each other. This is community celebration when you see each other. And in fact, this was the very beginning how they celebrated Mass. The Catholics, they have found something there in the old rite that rips open their souls with the passion of a lover. Have you ever realized how many young families and teenagers and children they have of these Masses? Talk to our teenagers, our life team. They want Latin. They want these traditional things which were some, for whatever reason, moved away. So what is lacking is a pastoral analysis of what has brought us to this point. And you don't fight each other, you should support each other. There's another common enemy, the devil himself. So I wanted to come to the very beginning of Christianity. In the second century, the church's defenses fell on the scholarly convert from Samaria, from Palestine, named Justin. We call him Saint Justin because he was martyred for his faith in year 165, so it's ancient Christianity. This is almost 2,000 years ago. This was a new generation of Christians. I was watching here what was happening in the States, when the first poor Polish immigrants, almost every nation the same, came not knowing the language, not very much skilled, so they were trying to survive, make their children educated. So their children, they already make the high school. These children, they make sure that their children, they will make some kind of college. And then the next generation is great specialists in very unique things. You know, this is graduate growth. So this is like the second generation of Christians when Justin would be, in our terms, like the professor of the university. The highly educated person who embraced Christianity seriously, and he was teaching it, living it, and teaching it. So it was Justin who lifted the veil of secrecy from the ancient liturgy, how the first Christians were celebrating Mass. And it's very similar to what we have now. In Anno Domini 155, he wrote to the Roman Emperor, Marcus Aurelius, describing what we can even now recognize as the Mass. If you present this text even to a child who just is after First Holy Communion, they will easily recognize we celebrate Mass. And this was the reason of the Vatican Council to return to the roots, to return to the beginning, how the Mass was celebrated. He wrote, "On the day we call the Day of the Sun, all who dwell in the city or country gather in the same place." So Justin begins his description by placing it squarely on the Day of the Sun, Sunday, which was the day Jesus rose from the dead. That's the ancient tradition from the apostles. So as the primary day of worship, Sunday had fulfilled and replaced the seventh day, the Sabbath of the Jews. So that's why we're celebrating. That's why we are embracing this celebration on Sunday. The memoirs of the apostles, the letters and the gospels and the writings of the prophets, this is the Old Testament, are read as much as time permits. Majority of them, they were slaves, the people who didn't have any freedom. So when they could come, maybe once a month, maybe even more seldom for Mass, they didn't come for 2 minutes of scripture readings. It was quite long time of presenting the scriptures. As it developed later, the first reading, the psalm, the second reading, the gospel, this is what we have in our church now. So when the reader has finished, he who presides over those who gather admonishes and challenges them to imitate these beautiful things. This is what we clearly recognize the homily, trying on the one side to explain, on the other side to motivate, to challenge the people to grow up in their spiritual life and dedication to God. Then we all rise together and offer prayers for ourselves and for all others, wherever they may be, so that we may be found righteous by our life and actions and faithful to the commandments, so as to obtain eternal salvation. So you can see after our homily there is coming profession of faith, just to remind ourselves what we believe, and coming to the general intercessions. In our church it's maybe more visible on the weekdays, when we are less in number, and I can give you a chance to express your own intention, praying together. What is the meaning of that, praying in the community? Because to be answered for your prayers, you have to have faith. You have to put your trust in God. And I might have not enough faith, but someone of you might have enough faith, and because of your faith, my prayers would be answered. And that's what is the beauty of praying in the community, interceding for each other. When the prayers are concluded, we exchange the keys. This is also in our schedule, it's just a different place. We have the sign of peace just before receiving the Holy Communion. And you can discuss, and both sides have equally valid arguments, just immediately after the liturgy of the word, before we enter the liturgy of Eucharist, we reconcile, pass the sign of the peace, or just before receiving the Holy Communion to reconcile with others. Both ways are correct, there is nothing wrong, but in our liturgy it's a different place. Then someone brings bread and cup of water and wine mixed together to him who presides over the brethren, so to the presbyteros, to the priest. This is what we are just doing in our church when our ushers are inviting families, some representatives who are bringing bread, wine and water to the altar as representation of your offering. You offer yourself to God, and some of you from the community are bringing the gifts that you have kind of shared in this offering, also reminding of necessity to offer yourself to God. He, the priest, takes them and offers praise and glory to the Father of the universe through the name of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. As we hear it when it's silent Mass, you hear all these prayers which are prayed by Jesus. And for a considerable time, he gives thanks, this preface which we have, Eucharisti, that we have been judged worthy of these gifts. Some people, they have this notion that I'm not worthy to receive the Holy Communion. And it's true, you are not, neither me. St. Catherine of Siena, she wanted to prepare herself as good as possible to be worthy to receive the Holy Communion. And Jesus cut it very clearly. You will be never, ever worthy to receive the Holy Communion. This is the canonized saint, doctor of the church. But he didn't leave her with this. I am worthy, Jesus said, that you enter into me, reversing the direction. Who is making favor whom? Entering to Jesus, this is what makes this enrichment and transformation of our lives. When he, the priest, has concluded the prayers of thanksgiving, all present give voice to an acclamation by saying Amen. And I'm trying to explain it, to motivate that you can get something from this Mass for yourself. This prayer is called doxology, when I'm having body, blood, soul and divinity on the altar, and going is through him, with him, with Christ, through Christ, going to the Heavenly Father. This is like summarizing all the prayers from the Mass. those who are spoken loudly, those who are hidden in your hearts, which you are praying secretly, everything going with Jesus to the Heavenly Father. And it's the highest moment of the Mass after the consecration because of having this Eucharistic species. C.S. Lewis was talking in somehow different context, but in the same way. God gave us the gift which he expects us to return to him as our gift to him. C.S. Lewis was writing that the little boy is coming to his father asking for some money. You know, parents, they should ask why the child needs money. And the little boy is answering, is a top secret. And the top secret is because daddy has birthday in 2-3 days' time, you know, and the child needs a bit of money to go to buy something and bring on the birthday day to honor his father. And on the day of the birthday, the father has to forget, it's out of my money. I could buy myself much bigger gifts, you know. Appreciating what the child is doing, teaching care for the others, acknowledging what is given to him. We have something like this every Mass. God is giving us his most precious gift, much more than 10 bucks, at our disposal, his son, his only begotten son, Jesus, and he expects us that in obedience we'll offer him back as our sacrifice, as our gift. And God is getting some kind of amnesia that it was his gift to us, and he takes this offering as if it was ours to honor him. Do you have anything better? Offering the second person of the Blessed Trinity to the first person, to God the Father. Offering Jesus to the Heavenly Father. If you say Amen, which means I believe, I want it, I sign up my name under this prayer, you do not have anything better, and we cannot be rejected if you are going with Jesus to the Heavenly Father. When he who presides has given thanks and the people have responded, there's a next part. Those whom we call deacons give to those present the Eucharistic bread, wine, and water. At that time, they didn't have water available, so they might be far away, that they don't faint, that they swallow, that nothing is wasted. They offer them also water. But it's Eucharistic bread and Eucharistic wine, body and blood, soul and divinity of Jesus offered to those. And even more, we have also this tradition a bit distorted now, and take them to those who are absent. This is 2,000 years ago. This is what we have, the Eucharistic ministers in the church who would go to the hospital to visit people at home because they were not able to come. That's how old the custom is. Of course, it's now distorted because of COVID. But as soon as we are done with this, it will return to this. See in what kind of tradition we are immersed. The Eucharistic celebration is a central issue that demands sober consideration by those who claim the name of Christ. It's called in the writings, documents of the Church, is the source and summit. It springs from the sacrifice of Jesus and is the highest worship which we can ever have, honoring God by offering to him ourselves together with Jesus. So Catholics must awaken and open their eye with wonder, gratitude, and godly fear, that Scott Hahn was calling to us, and also challenge the Protestants. They must step back and see things with more final focus, more historical and biblical lenses, how it came to our celebration, why you are doing what you are doing, and focusing on this, what you cannot see, the attitude from inside. So Justin writes, this food is called among us Eucharistia, the Eucharist, of which no one is allowed to partake but the man who, first of all, believes that the things which we teach are true. So when we have on the weddings or funerals many visitors in our church, and this is quite common practice all over the world, we inform the people that are welcome to join to pray with us, but as they don't believe, they don't receive. As Dr. David Anders said, you know, you do not salute flag which is not yours. He said, those who has been washed with the washing that is for the remission of sins and unto regeneration. So those who are baptized. See once more the order. First you believe, and then you are baptized. You are baptizing babies not because of their faith. We baptize babies because of the faith of their parents. And also very important is so those receive so living as Christ has enjoyed. So not committing sins. If you commit a sins, confession, and then receiving the Eucharist. That's how old, how ancient is this teaching. For not as common bread and common drink do we receive this, but in like manner as Jesus Christ our Savior, having been made flesh by the word of God, and had both flesh and blood for our salvation. So likewise we have been taught that the food which is blessed by the prayer of his word is the flesh and blood of that Jesus who was made flesh. That's how ancient the faith is. Body, blood, soul, and divinity explained from the very beginning of Christianity. We all need to listen to the Holy Spirit in his church and in his scriptures, remembering that the church is the pillar and bulwark of the truth. And the old traditions, they do not contradict the new one. In fact, if you go to the scripture, this happened already at Moses' time or after Moses has died. The book of Deuteronomy, one of which was prescribed to Moses, but Moses was already dead. This doesn't apply to the wandering through the desert. They dropped because they entered into the promised land. So this kind of adjusting to the environment, this is what helps the people. It was the history through the whole church. And please don't take extremists that are on both sides, extremists denying the things. They should cooperate. They could stream together to worship of God. They should motivate each other to embrace the mystery as much as possible. This sacredness, this mystery, this devotion, this visible decoration, altar servants, choir, music, readers, everything should help to come closer to God. And if you talk to any of our converts, those who are coming to our church, this usually the point, the reverence, the prayerfulness in the church. This is most important. If you come maybe to some consensus, I'm ready to make this Ad Orientem Mass for 6 weeks during Lent time to see the other form. How is this motivating? How is this helping to embrace the whole package of our faith? So through all the many centuries, God spoke with one voice through his church. Just take this voice, take the guidance, and don't put it somehow in strange attitude.